My name is Ton Hagenbeek. I'm a hematologist from the Academic Medical Center in Amsterdam, the Netherlands. And I will be happy to share with you on this lymphoma hub program the role of FDG PET after salvage chemotherapy and prior to autologous stem cell transplantation in Hodgkin lymphoma. And the question is, has that turned out to be a predictive factor? In other words, can we discriminate patients that really can profit from high-dose treatment and autologous stem cell transplantation if you have a chemosensitive first relapse? Can we discriminate those patients from patients where the relapse rate is so high that you better go for alternative strategies instead of subjecting these patients to marrow-ablative chemotherapy with all the side effects involved? Well, there are data out there, and one of the first reports comes from 2005. As I show you on this slide, from Jabbour and colleagues, where they studied retrospectively patients with relapsed Hodgkin lymphoma, 86% relapsed after ABVD first-line treatment. They were tested for chemosensitivity with a DHAP variant, ESHAD, and then all patients after two or three courses underwent a PET scanning, 68 patients. 43 appeared to have become PET negative, so they really were in a metabolic complete remission at 63%, whereas 25 patients, that's 37%, stayed in, still showed PET positivity after the completion of the courses of ESHAD. All these patients, no matter what the PET scan revealed, went to high dose treatment and autologous stem cell transplantation, and the results speak for themselves, although we must realize this is retrospective analysis. The patient that had become PET negative after ESHAP had a much better disease-free survival at 2 years, 65%, than those patients that went to autologous transplant with still PET positive disease to be demonstrated 30% 2 years disease-free survival. So this was one of the first signs that PET might be predictive in what would happen after autologous transplantation. There's another more recent report from Devilliers and colleagues in Hematologica with the outcome according to PET studies that's given on this slide, just prior to autologous stem cell transplantation, again a retrospective analysis with 85 patients that became negative, PET negative, after second line salvage chemotherapy versus PET positive patients. And again, here the data support that PET is predictive, 5 years progression-free survival, 79% in the PET-negative patients prior to transplant versus only 23% in the PET-positive patients. And the 5 years overall survival, 90% versus 55%. So highly significant differences. So this calls for new strategies. Going back to, I think, my colleagues in Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York that have been pioneering the predictive role of PET scan, Dr. Moscovich and his colleagues. On this next slide, it's a series that was followed from 1994 to 2003 of relapsing Hodgkin patients, and where they compared the event-free survival in patients that had a negative functional imaging after second-line treatment versus those who still were positive. And this is not only includes PET scanning, but in the early years, mainly gallium scanning. Pictures here again, negative, functional imaging negative patients prior to transplant fare much better than the positive patients. And they really put this into prospective trials, a great achievement in New York, as given on this slide, a simple, straightforward regimen, patients relapsing, first relapse or refractory to first-line treatment at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center, all receive ICE-based salvage chemotherapy. After a couple of courses, a PET scan is made. If the PET scan is negative, so if there's a metabolic complete remission, patients go immediately to high-dose treatment, HDT, followed by autologous stem cell transplantation. If the PET scan is still positive, there is second-line or third-line chemotherapy, GVD in this case, and then again the PET scan is performed, and if patients in second round become PET negative, they also go to autologous stem cell transplantation. And these are some of the interesting results given on these curves here at the right of the slide. The upper curves show all the PET negative patients either achieving PET negativity after ICE only or after ICE plus DVD doesn't really matter as long as prior to the high-dose treatment the PET is negative, the event-free survival looks quite good. But if the FDG PET stays positive, so still metabolic active disease, after GVHD or in ineligible patients, the outlook is much more grim. So this is in a prospective way a demonstration that PET may play an important role in predicting who is going to do well when a subsequent autologous transplant is performed and who is doing less well. Our patient, coming back to a patient that I presented in a previous presentation, a 66-year-old woman that relapsed after initial successful ABVD treatment with extensive disease and underwent 3 courses of DHAP, showed a PET negative remission, then underwent autologous transplantation. She fared well after transplantation, no major complications. She remains in complete remission now 3 years after autologous stem cell transplantation. And I think she's most probably cured, as we see most of the relapses within the first 2 years or something after the autologous stem cell transplantation. The question now is, in general, how to increase, now that we have seen that it's important that the patient reaches a PET negative metabolic complete remission before the rounding up of the treatment with high dose treatment and autologous stem cell transplantation. The question then arises how to increase the fraction of patients in the metabolic PET negative CR just prior to conditioning and autologous stem cell transplantation. And I think there are 3 major issues. One is to try to intensify salvage chemotherapy and conditioning regimen, and it was shown before by a large randomized trial that adding other drugs to high dose beam really doesn't change event-free survival as compared to beam alone, prospective randomized trial. Secondly, one might think about adding smart molecules to second-line chemotherapy, like everolimus, an mTOR inhibitor. That study is up and running. We are looking forward to the results. And thirdly, to add antibody-drug conjugates, one of the latest achievements in the treatment of Hodgkin lymphoma, to add those to second-line chemotherapy, like, as a speaking example, brentuximab vedotin. This is an example of adding a smart molecule, like everolimus, as I said, to DHAP, an ongoing study in the German Hodgkin Study Group. And in conclusion, I think the role of PET has been well established in terms of predicting a better outcome after second-line chemotherapy just prior to high-dose treatment and autologous stem cell transplantation. And there are now new studies up and running, prospective studies, to really see whether it can improve on the progression-free and overall survival if we use PET as an important parameter just prior to high-dose treatment.